no delta winding.
What's the difference in them? How they produce amperage versus voltage?
Shush. Shush.
This week on Autorestomod, Jeff and Cam talk alternators. Be sure to like and subscribe for more great videos on classic car mods and restorations.
National Parts Depot offers quality restoration parts for Mustang, Cougar, Camaro, Firebird, Chevelle, GTO, Chevy and Ford trucks, Bronco and Thunderbirds. For quality parts in stock and delivered fast from our four warehouses nationwide, nobody beats NPD's speed and service. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free. NPD, make your dream happen.
Ooh, starty charty things.
Yes, alternators. We did a video a while back. Everybody hates it.
Yep.
Well, not everybody. A lot of people thought it was okay, but there are some people that were really kind of haterating on it. Mm-hmm. Some of the comments were ugly enough, I actually had to delete them.
Nice.
I normally don't do that, but when you call me an effing idiot, I kind of delete you. Anytime you use cuss words, when you're commenting to us, I am going to delete your comment. Just know that. In any case, here we go, alternators. Just, I don't want to do anything super in-depth.
Yeah, because we could go into delta windings, Y windings.
No delta
what
windings.
What the difference in them, how they produce amperage versus voltage.
Shush. Shush. No. It's no. It's not going to be that. It's not going to be.
Wow. It's a lot of breakfast.
Damn. Unfortunately, it didn't go up your nose. All right, so what we're going to go into is kind of an overview on alternators. Because, I mean, there are guys that will find that incredibly interesting.
Yeah.
Because it is interesting.
I find it interesting.
I do too, but I think for the average guy, they're not going to be worrying about delta and Y windings and what the differences in those are. Mm-hmm. They're going to want to know why their car ain't charging. And they're going to want to know the differences in the alternators and why a one-wire versus a three-wire alternator.
Yep.
All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you do the first one because it's trouble things and you're really good at trouble. So I'm going to have you do the first one and then I'll take over and talk about Ford alternators because we talked about them already and you're still not quite clear on all the G's and what they mean. So I'm going to duck out. You duck in.
Okay. All right, so diagnosing charging systems. A couple things you should use. Personally, I use a stethoscope and a digital voltmeter, ohmmeter. This is like 90% of your diag. Something else I don't have up here is a headlight. I use that to load test harnesses, check for resistance. So one of the most common problems is low voltage. If you're replacing your battery, say every 3-4 months, it's not holding a charge, check your voltage. If you're putting low voltage into that battery, it's constantly straining the lead walls in it, and you will eat away the battery. Charging system is going to kill that every time. So all you do is go up to your battery, check for voltage. You should have between 13.5 to 14.7 volts on the battery posts. So the number two is radio hum. If you're going down the road and you can hear your engine RPM over the radio, you have a problem. Either your charging system diodes are breaking down, it's putting AC voltage into your power system, or you could have a spark plug wire problem, so your radio suppression on your plug wires is bad. But either way, that's a pretty common problem for an alternator. If you think it's humming, but you can't narrow it down, the best way is to turn it to AM stations and just go through the gears. Even if it's a manual or automatic, you will hear the engine RPM. Yeah, it sounds kind of cool, but you don't want it. And another cause for radio hum is also grounding of the alternator. If it's not got a good ground, your voltage is going to be hunting, so to speak. So it could be grounding out through your speakers and through your radio head itself. All right, so the third most common is actually a loose belt. If you look at this, this is basically an inverse motor. This takes horsepower to turn and outputs power. So this requires force. If your belt is loose, it will slip, but it is also too tight, you will side load the bearings, which brings us to our next one, which is bad bearings. If you can take your stethoscope and put it on the case and you hear a child screaming inside of it, then you have a bad bearing. Also, if it sounds like our wonderful little bench grinder over here, which I'm going to turn on and turn off in just a second, you'll hear what a bad bearing sounds like. That. Right at the end there, that little whiny and grindy sound. That's a bad bearing. That'll cause a whole bunch of problems. If your bearing goes out, the armature could be wobbling inside your windings, causing a very weird voltage pattern to be produced, not this typical sine wave that you get from an alternator before the rectifier bridge. And the final one, which is the whole reason that we have this system up here, is old or damaged wiring. Now, this is out of the truck. This is the entire charging system. We just unbolted everything because we're not using it anyway. So as you can see, wonderful friends have scotch-locked all kinds of wires. I've actually cut a bunch of scotch locks out of this to wire in the horn and other things. If you look, you can't really see in there, but you can see on here, these terminals are really corroded. That is going to drop your amperage across these pins. There's cut wires all in here. This is a fusible link and there's something gigantic taped to it, so that's probably not good. Yeah, old damaged wiring. This is where a headlight comes in for testing purposes. If you think you have bad wiring, the best way to do it is to load test that harness. So you'll actually run the headlight through this wire. And if it pulls the amp load, then that wire's fine. But if it doesn't, that wire's bad.
All right, now what I'm going to talk about is alternators that the big three had in their cars. And basically, they're all the same style of alternator pretty much, but I'm going to go over nomenclature and what their capabilities were. Now, what I've got here on the table right in front of me, the one I'm most familiar with, and that is the Ford alternator. Now, Ford, when they went to the alternator in 1964 or 5, they used what is called a 1G alternator. Now, you'll hear a lot in the hobby about whether your car has a 1G, 2G, or 3G alternator. Basically, all that means in the nomenclature is that this alternator or that alternator is a first generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation. After the fourth generation alternators, Ford moved on to a different nomenclature on them, and I'm not going to get off into that. But for you early car guys, which is where our focus is, it's 1G, 2G, or 3G, and all that means is first, second, or third generation. Now, all Ford alternators up to the 2G alternator used an external regulator on them. And basically, a 1G alternator is an external fan with an external regulator. Those alternators typically were only available up to about a 55 amp alternator range all the way through to the early 80s. Ford did have bigger alternators that they used on certain applications. Our 72 Mach 1, for instance, has a Ford 65 amp alternator, and that car is loaded. It's got a rear window defroster, it's got air conditioning, it's got power windows on it. So with all that amperage being flowed through the car, they wanted a larger alternator to cope with that amount of potential amperage. So they have a 65 amp alternator, but it looks different than this. It's got a different case assembly on it. When they moved now to the 2G alternator, the 2G alternator is an external fan, and the regulator then moves to the back here with a three-prong male plug. I don't have one of those in the shop right now, but I'm putting one up on the screen so you can take a look at what that looks like. That is your 2G alternator. Not the preferred alternator when you're going into a modified situation on a classic car. Most guys would prefer you to move on to the next alternator I'm going to talk about, which is your 3G alternator. Now the 3G alternator, case-wise, very similar to this, was still in use on the 94-ish Mustangs, but with the 3G, it's still internally regulated. It has a dual fan setup. It has an external fan and an internal fan, and can be had in a lot of different sizes. You know, you can get anywhere from a 90 to 120 amp alternator. The 2G alternators tend to be basically top end to 75 amps. So that's the Ford side of things as far as most guys are going to be dealing with. The 4G alternators, those were used on the 4.6. The mounting procedures on them are a little bit different, so they really won't fly in with what you can do on a classic car like the 3G on back wheel. Most every time you're looking at a high performance alternator for a classic Ford, like the ones that PA Performance sells, those alternators are all, you know, you can get the higher amperage out of the 3G alternator. All right, now I'm going to move on from this to the GM side of things and their nomenclature, which is a little bit different than Ford. All right, now what I've got here, as I move that Ford one out of the way, is basically, this is our alternator for the Ford pickup truck, and it's based off of a GM style of alternator. This is a one wire, but I'm gonna use this as my example for the GM side of things. Your GM alternators started off life in the DN series, and what DN stood for was
Delcotron.
I don't know why I have to do that, but it's anything with a Tron on the end of it or that kind of stuff. Like Ford had, I don't know, Select Aero, air conditioning and stuff like that. Anyway, DN was Delcatron. So that was the beginning of it. Externally regulated up through about 68 or 69 on the GM side of things. Those alternators were woefully underpowered for most classic cars. A lot of guys in the GM side will be moving on from the DN style alternator, unless they're doing a full-on restoration, to the SI, which I'll go into next. Most of your DN alternators at the most were 45 to 50 amps. There probably are some examples out there where there's a little more power to it, but on the whole, DN was a lower powered alternator, externally regulated. This is the basis of what would come on next, which is the SI, which stands for Systems Integrated. What that means is that the voltage regulator is now inside of the alternator on the GM stuff. And yes, they adopted this a lot earlier than Ford. That's one thing about Ford that always kind of puzzles me, is they will adopt things later. They were not one of the first ones to go to alternator. They were not one of the first ones to go to an internally regulated system. GM, Mopar actually beat them to the punch on a lot of that stuff. In any case, the SI series of alternators can be had in a varying number and different sizes. Your average on them, though, is a maximum of about 60 amps, but the case is basically the same. You can take and bolt an SI into a DN setup, remove the regulator, and use it. You're still going to have more wiring on it than you would have, say, on a one-wire system like the one I'm holding here in my hand. From there, General Motors moved on to the CS series of alternators. Now, the CS alternators are available in much higher amperages. You can go 90 and 120, maybe even more, when you get into the CS series, but those alternators are pretty much all serpentine system alternators. Case stays pretty much the same, but they moved on to a serpentine system in the late 80s on into the 90s. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull this out of the way and talk about the Mopars. Now here in front of me we have the Mopar alternator that I don't have one because we haven't had a Mopar in the shop. It's not my fault. It just happens. We don't have a Mopar in the shop, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over Mopars anyway. I'll probably put some kind of flashy photograph of Mopar alternators up right here. Basically, your Mopar alternators come in three varieties. You have the round back, the square back, and the compact. Those are really the way they are. And it basically goes from the round back being early series. 60-61, the Mopar guys were already running alternators, so they beat Ford to the punch by like 3 or 4 years. But there wasn't much to them. The early stuff, maximum 35 amp draw. So Mopar really didn't expect you to order a whole lot of options back in the day when you were working with it, because let's face it, if you're running a maximum of 35 amps, you can't put a whole lot of draw on that system without it just bogging it down and killing it. So early ones were 35 amp. They were externally regulated, much like the Ford and the GM stuff on the early side as well. All the roundback alternators from 1960 to 1968 were single pole terminals on the back. In 1970, they moved to a two pole setup on these so they could go with an electronic voltage regulator. Now in 1972, Mopar moved to the square back alternator. Now the square back is one that has a little bit better draw to, or a little bit better amperage to it. It's a little bit better alternator. The round backs tend to be only about 60 amps, and some of these other ones had more amperes to them. But what I will say is, from what I've read, the bigger 100 amp alternators were like the one that I talked about in the Ford side of things. It's a bigger, heavier duty case, and the mounting brackets are different. Most of those that have the 100 amp setups are for police and ambulance packages, because they ran lights, sirens, had air conditioning in some of the cars, so they wanted a bigger alternator to cope with all that. From there, Chrysler moved on to the compact alternators, and these are the ones that the guys in the Mopar side of things tend to want to look for, because they can be had in 90 and 120 amp configurations. It's a pretty well-liked alternator in the Mopar hobby. Mounts up to pretty much all the small and big block stuff that they have out there. At least that's what I've read. I don't know for sure, because I'm not a Mopar guy. It's not that I don't want to be, because my wife loves them. Just hadn't got one yet. Somebody wants to give us a Mopar that's really cool, I'll take it from you. Looking for a charger, maybe a duster. If you want to give us a free one, I'll take it. That's all I got for you right now on this. Going to keep moving on. Cam's going to talk about the next thing. This is what a lot of guys do. And there's there are reasons to do this.
There are advantages, yes.
Yeah, there are advantages. One of the biggest things, though, this is actually, what's funny to me is this is an industrial application.
Yeah.
This was not designed to be used on the car. It was actually designed to be used in tractors and industrial apps.
Yeah, you got one wire. And that's all you need.
That's all you need because you're running headlights or maybe lights or something.
As long as you have a ground tab there, but as long as it grounds good enough through the case, you don't really need it.
Yeah, although like most of the guys will add, they want you to ground it to this tab too, just because a lot of times guys aren't ground wires.
Yeah.
I don't know, like the pickup truck, when we got it, there was no ground wire at all.
To the engine, to the firewall.
And that's really important to ground to the chassis. But I think the funny thing about this is the hot ticket. Everybody thinks it's really cool. And the real basic reason for running a one-wire alternator is pretty.
Yeah. Cleans up the engine bay. You get rid of the external voltage regulator, all the wiring for it.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's the only reason to do this.
Yeah. And to me...
Well, not the only reason. And I'll go into this, but go ahead and say what you're going
to
say.
To me, it's kind of like half dozen one, 50 of the other. Because, well, that doesn't make sense. But...
Go on.
But, okay, the voltage regulator is the most common thing to fail in one of these.
Yes.
Yeah, because it houses the rectifier bridge and everything like that. If that fails, you have to replace the whole alternator, or you have to tear it apart and source a voltage regulator for an internal alternator.
And you know, one of the things I was going to go over that we're going to go over in just a minute is some of that kind of stuff of rebuilding things and all that, because we're going to talk about that, you know, as our next section on this. But yeah, the voltage regulator is the thing that fails. So a one-wire alternator, if it fails...
Yeah.
is more likely to have to be replaced, and then you have to try to source a one-wire alternator for your car, and you have to try to source a one-wire alternator if you have a lot of stuff on your car
for
that's 100 amp or whatever. So you're having to try to get all that pulled together and pulled into wherever you are, because it's not going to fail while you're near the house. It's going to fail probably when you're on the road.
And if you have an external voltage regulator, you can just keep one in the trunk.
Yeah, you keep a spare.
Yeah.
And I agree with you on that. I mean, there's some of that to it. But one of the things I will say about this is, like we're doing an American Auto Wire harness in the 72 truck.
It's built for it.
It's built for this.
Yeah, the harness is made for it.
So, and that's not just the only one. There's a ton of folks out there that are building the harnesses that are one wire specific.
Because it makes the harnesses cheaper. You have less circuits, less
power. Yeah, and it's just clean. I mean, everybody wants clean. If you're doing an American Auto Wire harness and you're spending the money on that, which I think it's a good thing, some of the things that we do to our cars around here especially, the 69 wagon, we're basically opening a branch office on that car with wiring because we're out of circuits on the stock harness. So the truck, we just went ahead and cut the baby in half and said we're going to do an American Auto Wire. And when we did that, then it brought on the one wire alternator. So basically, it's two things, in my opinion, twofold beauty. And then if you've got a car that uses one of the aftermarket harnesses, it's a good way to get into that.
Yeah. Otherwise, it does the same thing.
Basically, that's all it really is it does the same thing. Now, what I want to do is I'm going to pull a couple of the alternators back in here because I want to talk about some of the issues you can run into with things and some of the myths that people perpetrate on these. One of them being about charging.
Yes.
Bring her in here, man.
Nice and chromy.
Yes, it's the chromadium version. You know that adds like 25 amps to the charging capabilities.
Yeah, like 10 horsepower.
Least.
Yeah.
I don't even know where that one came from. It just appeared out of nowhere. Beyond that, one of the first things I wanted to do on this, because I want to go over some tips, tricks, and some myths and things. One of the myths that perpetrates in the hobby is that you have to have your RPM above a certain rate to run a one-wire alternator.
Which isn't true.
It's not really true, because anymore, these things are so tightly built.
Yeah, once the voltage regulator gets... once it excites on the field wire, it runs constant.
Yeah, and it doesn't matter what the RPM is. Unless the engine shuts down, it stays excited the entire time. So that's one of the myths that people say, well, you have to have it above 1,000 RPM all the time.
And if they have to have it above 1,000 RPM, it's because they have more than likely the wrong pulley on it. They need to actually do the math to figure out what RPM the alternator is spinning at idle.
That's a point, too, because a lot of guys don't realize that it's not necessarily an issue with the alternator other than you're not running it fast enough to pull good amperage.
Yeah, if you're having to hold it at 1,500 RPM to charge, you need a smaller pulley on it to spin it faster.
Right, and that's something, because the factory did that.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times guys will go and do the pulleys to change the performance.
Yeah, underdrive, overdrive pulleys.
Yeah, and I'm okay with that. I think...
As long as it keeps it in the right range.
Yeah, because a lot of guys, I don't think, go in and do the math on it.
Yeah, because like if you're running a high RPM build, you have to do the math on your power steering pump or your alternator so you don't blow it apart.
Right.
Because if you run 7,000 RPM and that pulley is half the size of your crank pulley, you're running that at 14,000 RPM.
And yeah, and like General Motors, the Z28, the mm-hmm. Boss 302, some yep. of the early performance cars.
Different size pulleys.
Different size pulleys on the power steering pump, different mm-hmm. size pulleys on the main pulley.
Yep.
And they ratioed those out because they didn't want the warranty claims.
Yeah.
Even though Ford had a problem with the pistons on the Boss 302, but that's another story altogether. Any case, so that's one of the things that I find is a quote-unquote myth that these things have to be run above 1,000 RPM to excite the alternator to make it work. That's not necessarily true. The only time you can have a real problem with one of these would be the fact of just having it, you know, the pulley too big or too small, depending, to run it at the right mm-hmm. RPM to keep it charging. Yeah. Not to keep it charging. It's going to charge, but it's not going to pull as much.
Yeah.
As it would at full chat.
If the OEM of the alternator wants 1,000 RPM and you're only running it at 800, it's not going to pull voltage.
Right.
Not the voltage that you need.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, actually, it will pull voltage.
Yeah, it'll be pulling out 10 volts.
Right.
It's not enough charge back.
Right. One of the other things I wanted to talk about, and this is something you and I have discussed before, mm-hmm. is on an alternator like this, I always, if you have a three-bolt system, like Ford is really big with the three-bolt system.
Yeah, they love it.
They love it. I always will go in and put never seize on the bolt shank.
I coat it. I've had one seize and snap. That was not a fun time.
I mean, I've seen them bad enough where they break off inside the body mm-hmm. of the, and you might as well just throw the whole thing away.
Yep.
Because it's going to be so hard to get that out of there.
Yeah.
Never seize is your best friend mm-hmm. whenever you're working with this, because I'm telling you right
it's
now.
It's an aluminum housing and a steel bolt.
Yeah, there's going to be some kind of, you know, with electrolysis, electrolysis.
Yeah.
So always make sure that you do that when you're working with one of these. I know it's going to be messy if you're taking it apart, but trust me.
It'll be worth it.
Well worth it. Now, one of the other things I want to kind of go over on this is when you're going to an alternator that's not a factory application to your particular vehicle, always keep your old alternator until you're completely done. And I'll say that for this reason. If you take and look at our Ford alternator here, next to our new alternator that we're going to be putting in the 72 Ford pickup truck, you'll notice that there is a shoulder right here on the Ford alternator. Now, this being chrome plated and polished, that shoulder is just a little bit shorter than I've seen on some of the other ones. I have another alternator around here, much taller shoulder. You want to make sure that the basically the pass-through tube is the same size on both of these. And I like to make things same. I want my bolt to only go in so far. So what I've done here on this one, after looking at the alternator that was actually on the truck, I've added a washer behind the stock washer here to mimic that depth, because our one wire that we're putting on has no shoulder on it. So I wanted to make sure that our depth is the same on that. Always check every little thing on the alternator to make sure that it's going to bolt in the way you want it to bolt in. That's the only spot we have a problem on this, other than possibly a bolt issue here. This may require a metric fastener. I haven't done the check on it yet, but the stock one will not thread into here, and it does thread into this one, which is not the one that came off the truck. So this tells me that we may have a metric fastener on this or a different size fastener, and we'll have to source a different fastener here. You want to get all that taken care of before you try to bolt something like this in the car.
Don't take your core with you when you pick it up.
Yeah, no, just take and give that back later. Yeah. You can take the core back at another time. It'll save you a little bit of headache. Another thing I wanted to talk about is we talked to one of the guys at PA Performance, and he discussed with us large alternators. It's kind of mm-hmm. like the carburetor thing. Everybody has the go big or go home.
Yeah, you don't need a 200 amp alternator when you're just running like an 8.
Yeah, and because
sub or something like that.
Because he was basically saying this. He said, what you really want to do whenever you're sourcing your alternator is you want to go to whatever you need mm-hmm. and add 20%.
Yeah. I'd add like, if you don't want to do the math, I'd add like 20 or 30 amps to it. Because if you're only pulling 75 amps at the max, headlights on, radio blaring, windshield wipers on, all that kind of stuff. And
a lot of people don't consider having everything on with the high beams. Because
yeah.
if you're doing your test, what I would do is if you already have everything on the car and you're buying an alternator because you're having a charging issue, see what your load is mm-hmm. and then go in. What he recommends is basically taking and finding out what your amperage load is with the windshield wipers on full, with your headlights on high beam.
Everything on.
What your amperage load on all of those different items are, the subwoofers, the radio, because all that stuff is out there. There's information provided from the manufacturers of all the parts to let you know what your amperage load is.
Yep.
Take that, put 20% over the top.
Yep. So that way you're not, if you have a 200 amp alternator and you're only pulling 50 amps constant, it's just spinning.
And really what he said about that too is with a 200 amp alternator, your life cycle is shorter because of how big it is.
Yeah.
There's more heat, there's more, it's drawing more power, so you don't need all that. You want to right size it. It's kind of like what we were talking about with the pulleys.
Yeah.
The manufacturers went to a lot of trouble to right size the pulleys. You want to right size your alternator for your application.
Put a 700 CFM carburetor on a 302, it's going to choke.
It's not going to be happy at all. And it's the same thing with an alternator. You put a 200 amp alternator on a system that doesn't require the 200 amps, A, you're spending too much money, and B, you're going in and you're using an alternator that's going to eventually fail quicker because you're just so much more mass, so many more things going on inside of it than a smaller alternator, so you don't want to have to deal with that. Now, one of the other things is heat is the enemy.
Yes, that is where like the 3G alternator comes in handy because it has an internal and an external fan.
Yes, so you got more airflow, the more airflow, the better. And one of the things I will say about that too is it's a lot about climate, where you're at. If you're in Phoenix, Arizona, and you're running, you know, an alternator, you're going to lose probably 10%, maybe a little bit more of your
heat is the enemy of electronics.
Yes, and it can cause you a lot of problems. As far as you may have a 75 amp alternator, but the heat it's a 65 amp alternator or 100 amp, 90 amp in the heat. And so you need to make sure you understand that when you're ordering. I think that's why the guys at PA were talking about you need to go in.
Bump,
you get a 20% bump. That way you've got the 10% cushion. So that's that. Well, other than not having the Mopar alternator.
Shocker. No one wants to let us have their Mopar for a day.
I don't want it for a day. Yeah. Deanna really wants a charger. I'm not sure.
I saw her driving the new Mustang.
All right, well, I guess that's our show for this week, folks. If you have any input that you would like to add to this, if you Mopar guys want to lambast me for the Mopar section, I do apologize. I've not done a lot of Mopars. I've probably said some things wrong. If you'd like to put it in the comment sections below, please feel free. Just don't cuss at me on this one. If you cuss at me, I am not going to address you. I will delete you. Bye-bye. So, that's our show for this week. Y'all have a great week. See you later. Come back and see us next time on Autorestomod.
Guess what? I'm all charged up.
Oh my God. It's like bad dad memes or something.